Good morning, Corinth Church. Psalm 96, really honestly, Psalm 90 through 150 are just amazing. Obviously, all the Psalms are amazing, but I love Psalm 96. It talks about singing a new song to the Lord, and then again about the nations testifying to the goodness of the Lord. And so this morning, as we come and we do sing a new song to the Lord, we sing a new song to the Lord because His mercies are new every morning. His grace is new every morning. His love is new every morning. If we were to spend the next 1,000 years trying to learn 1,000 new things about God every day, we would run out of time because that's how great and awesome our Lord is. So this morning, as we come to worship Him, we come standing in a long line of people that have lifted high the cross of Jesus Christ and said, we're singing to the only one that makes the eternal difference in everything. Let's pray. Jesus Christ, thank you so much for putting a new song on our lips. Thank you for being the God of everything, Lord God. You are the creator, the sustainer, the Alpha and the Omega. May you be lifted high and glorified in this. In your awesome name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Let's stand and sing. I can't count the times I've called your name some broken night. But you showed up and patched me up like you do every time. Good God Almighty, more faithful than the morning sun. I praise your name for all the things you've done. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good?
He is good.
Tell me, is he God?
He is good.
He is good God Almighty. They say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'd be somebody that you're not? Like the sun in the morning, I know you're gonna be there every day. So what on earth could make me be afraid? Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good?
He is good.
Tell me, is he God?
He is God.
Yes, he is good God Almighty. We're singing, praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him when the sun goes down. Praise him in the morning, love him in the noontime, love him when the sun goes down. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good? Tell me, is he God?
He is God.
He is good God Almighty. We're singing Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down. This is a new song, so sing along with us as it begins to be familiar to you here. I believe in the blood of Jesus that washes white as snow. I believe in the power of the gospel, still makes a broken hole. I believe that the curse of sin was broken when they rolled away that stone. I believe, I believe, I believe. Let's do the verse again. I believe in the blood
of Jesus that washes white as snow. I believe in the power of the gospel still makes a broken whole. I believe that the curse of sin was broken when they rolled away that stone. I believe as I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. And no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. I believe that the walls will stop falling when we fall down on our knees. I believe that the lame will go walking and the blind are gonna see. I believe that the gates of hell will tremble when the church begins to sing. I believe. And as I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. And no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. Sing it to the daughters, sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness, that the light has come. Sing it to the nations, look at what the Lord has done. And sing it to the daughters, sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. And sing it to the darkness, that the light has come. Sing it to the nations, look at what the Lord has done. And sing it to the daughters, sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. And sing it to the darkness, that the light has come. Sing it to the nations, look at what the Lord has done. Look at what the Lord has done. And as I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. And no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. And no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in.
Would you pray with me, please? God, it's so good to be in your house again today. We thank you and praise you for this another sunny morning. And we ask, God, that you would be the sun in this building today, that you would indwell this place, God. We praise you and worship you today and lift you high. Pray that each person here would be blessed by you in a special way. Thank you, God, for yet one more Sunday morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So there's a children's message coming, but you got to say hello to your neighbor first.
Nikki and Eva, and we are talking about David and Goliath today in church. Y'all know the story about David and Goliath, right? That David was this really small, handsome guy that defeated this giant, right? This giant was like 9 foot tall, and his name was Goliath, okay? We're gonna do an experiment, okay? Are y'all ready? Yeah. So I need David, or I need Goliath, okay?
Who's Goliath?
You be Goliath. Okay. Sound good? You're gonna take this Coke.
I know.
You ready? And you're gonna squeeze it as hard as you can to see how fast it goes up, okay? No Mentos, just squeeze it as far as you can, all right? Let us get out of the way first. On the count of three, you're gonna squeeze it, okay? One.
What if it goes in me?
Two, three.
Can I drink it now?
Not yet. Come here. Come here, David. So we see that Goliath went pretty high, right? So Goliath was always talking, and he was a Philistine that they were going to fight. So now we have David enter the story, right? So David only had 5 stones, okay? I'm going to give you 5 stones. You ready?
No!
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? So, David only had 5 stones, and what else did he have? Do we know? He had a slingshot, and he also had faith, right? He had faith that God was going to protect him. Okay, so on the count of three, you're going to drop the Mentos into the Coke and run, okay?
Okay.
All right?
Oh, yeah, run with your life.
Ready? 1.
All right,
2. 3.
Oh, man, it's going to be bad. Yes! Yes!
Beautiful, oh my.
Final 5, then, come on! It's going to be awesome.
Oh, see, it's still going.
You will go in and you will make another explosion.
So, we saw that David's went a lot higher. Come here, guys.
I want to drink it now.
I know.
Why it's exploding.
So, we saw that David's went a lot higher, right? Both of them went pretty high, but David's had a lot more oomph to it, didn't it? Yes. So, in the story of David Goliath, we see that his faith caused him to have some crazy stories, right? Like, this was an amazing story that he had, right? That he defeated this giant with only, technically, 3 stones. So we saw that you only had to put 1 in and that exploded. So as we saw, David had faith that it was going to explode, right? I mean, we knew it was happening. He had faith and only 3 stones that took him down, right? So that's what, as we talk today and Sunday in church, we're going to learn that David had faith and he had amazing stories from that faith. That he defeated a giant and he could go and tell people, God is so good, he helped me defeat this giant, right? So today, as you go from church or as you go from Sunday school or Wednesday night, remember that no matter what, God is with you, and you're going to have some amazing stories to tell. They may be little stories or big stories, but they'll have an impact on somebody, like David's story with Goliath, right? Yes, yes. Let's pray real quick, and then we'll head out and try to clean all this up, okay? Dear Lord, we come to you today, and we thank you for allowing us to see your heart, to see your mind and your heart. We thank you for allowing us to be together and learn more about you. We ask that you show us your stories, even if we can't see them right off the bat. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Bye, guys!
Thank you, Hannah. That's a great way to introduce our theme of the day, our scripture with David and Goliath. And we are so glad that you have joined us today. If you're in person, please find the friendship pad. And if you're on the YouTube stream, then you can find your bulletin at corinthtoday.org/now. But just looking around, we're so glad to see you and have you worshiping with us today. A lot of important announcements on the back of your bulletin. I'm not going to go through them in detail. We have a lot of special parts of our worship service today. But there's something on the back for everyone, moms and families with a loved one battling addiction and youth and Habitat and more. And if there's nothing else that connects with your world, we bet there's some group on Wednesday nights that will connect with you as well. All that's there. Don't forget the trunk or treat that's coming up just in a couple of more weeks, and we still need your trunks and candy and kids to join us. So at this time, we are privileged today to have a very special service of baptism, and I want to invite the Payne family forward, Eva and Big Brother Knox. Good to have Richard and Debbie with us too, the grandparents. And you know what? We're going to hold that just a moment because somebody forgot to bring the baptism font out and actually put water in it. which is kind of important. So we're going to hear next from Parker Murray while we get the baptism font ready, and then we'll have the baptism, okay? I'm looking over there going like, where's the font? Okay, Parker. This is one of our missionary partners, Parker Murray. He's going to tell you a little bit about what's going on in his world.
Hey, guys. Yeah, so like Bob said, my name is Parker Murray. My wife and daughter would usually be here. We're actually staying in the Lane Mission House right now, and baby Sky is still asleep, praise God. So I was not going to wake her up. But yeah, my wife and I, Laura, have been on staff with Crew, or Campus Crusade for Christ, for, I don't know, since, what was that, 2013, 2014? So however many years that's been now. And so we serve in northwestern Africa, in a closed country. It's a very closed country, Islamic Republic, and so we've been there, I guess, living for 5 or 6 years now. And so Corinth has been one of our main sending churches, whether it's through individual families and stuff. I know a lot of you guys here support us personally, and then the church as a whole has been just instrumental in seeing us be over there. And so what we do is we actually run a gym. We are gym owners. We just opened up about 8 months ago or so, and Corinth was huge in getting that up and running, and that just allows us to be in the country, to stay in the country. Before that, we taught English as our way in, because in our country you can't go in as a missionary. Feels weird to even say that word, but doing what we do. And so we've seen the Lord been super faithful over the past 5-6 years, and kind of our vision for the place is to see local house church be brought up, disciples making disciples, locals reaching their own families, their friends, their communities, themselves, essentially allowing us to leave. And so we've seen the Lord be faithful to that. We meet now in house church with one person, with one local, which is really good. And it's been really cool to see how God has changed his life and has made him really faithful and made him bold to step out and to share with his friends in a place that could put him in jail pretty easily for what he's doing, or even worse. And so it's really cool and encouraging to see his faith in God and his trust in that. So I won't take too much time unless you just need me to we love it. It's good. Definitely a dark place, definitely a harder place to live. We're thankful to be back in the States. I guess why we're here, we're having baby number two, and so Laura's due really any day now. It's been great here at Corinth. We're being able to stay in the mission house, been a huge blessing, and then when the baby comes, we'll go up for a few weeks at least by Laura's parents, but we'll be around town for a few months at least until we go back. So I just wanted to thank you guys personally. If you're on our team, if you know us, keep up with us. We want to thank you guys and just Corinth as a whole as well for how you guys support us overseas. So
may I pray for you?
Please, yeah.
So I grew up in a country in that part of the world as a missionary kid. So there's something about your story that also connects to me. You just kind of look the part, Parker. Like you look like you belong there, like my dad always did. So
that's right.
Let me pray for you. God, thank you for your call on Parker and Laura's life and for bringing them into our church family through Pastor Paul and others who nurtured them and loved them early on. And now that you've given them this calling in a very dark and difficult place, they want to be faithful to you. And we pray that the word will prosper, that the church will grow, that these disciples truly will, though few in number, grow and multiply, and that we will see the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ penetrate that window of the world where oftentimes even the things that you are doing we can't talk about. So we trust you and look to you and thank you that your plan is so much greater, and that the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of God as the waters cover the sea. Bless and protect this family. Bless little Sky as she grows up, and the little one to be born through this delivery. Watch over their family and use them and refresh them during this time when they're in the States. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And we will be around afterwards. I'm gonna head back and help Laura with the baby. But if you guys want to be added to our email list and keep up with us on a more regular basis, feel free to find me or Bob or Paul or somebody, and we'll get you on there.
Will you be around after this service or after 11?
Yes.
So if you can be after this service, just come to the back about 9:30 or so.
Okay.
If you can't, it's okay.
Yeah.
But we that'd be a good place
if
for people.
If not, we'll be around before the 11 o'clock.
Okay.
And if you can't find us, then
email
Paul,
me
Bob.
And or Paul, and we'll get you in touch with the Murrays.
All right, Bob.
Thank you. Love you.
Next time.
Okay, ready for you. You're up first.
Jesus Christ said, "Go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age." So if you're like me and you grew up Southern Baptist and you're thinking, what are you getting ready to do right now? Part of baptizing an infant is that we are saying, or the family is saying, we're coming underneath the covenant of Jesus Christ to raise this child up, to profess Christ as Savior. And as Kevin DeYoung eloquently says it in his book, he says, you know, even when you come, you know, even if you believe in believer's baptism and you're into believer's baptism, you don't treat that child like a little pagan until they accept Christ as their Lord and Savior. You treat them as under the covenant as well. So this is coming under the seal of the covenant of Jesus Christ that the family will raise this child to confess Jesus Christ as Lord.
So this is not the first time I've ever forgotten the baptism water, and I've never admitted this publicly, but like 25 years ago when I baptized a kid, it's the moisture in the air. So, you know, but this time we actually do have water in the baptismal font. We've taken care of that. We're not about quantity of water here, but we do want a little bit in there. So it is my privilege to ask you some questions in preparation for the baptism. So first to Adam and Sarah, do you desire to have your child baptized in the faith and family of Jesus Christ? So to the parents and grandparents here who are this extended family nurturing this child, will you teach Eva that she will be led to profess Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior? If so, please answer, "We will with the help of God." And do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow with her in the Christian faith, to help her to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ by celebrating Christ's presence, furthering his mission in all the world, and offering the nurture of the church family so that she may claim for herself this faith in Jesus? If so, please answer, "We promise with the help of God." And what is the full name of this child? I think she loves me already. Yeah. Eva Claire Payne, I baptize you now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We all share in a commitment of faith to love and nurture these little ones and to nurture her faith. So, Corinth Church, do you who have witnessed and celebrate this baptism promise your love, support, and care for this one who has been baptized as he and she lives there and grows in Christ, also to change her diapers, to take her on youth retreats, all that kind of stuff? If you do, say, "We promise our love, support, and care."
We promise our love, support, and care.
Please pray with me. Father, Son, Spirit, thank you so much for Eva. She is a little bit of your goodness in the land that we are living in now, that we were singing about. God, I pray for her story, her life, that she would never know a day apart from your love because of her parents and because of this church, because of you, Holy Spirit, your work in her. God, thank you for her. Again, we pray that she would love and trust you all the days of her life, and she'd witness to your goodness. Would she receive the love her parents give her and her family gives her as love from you? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
She's amening all the way through that prayer. That's awesome, Kevin. As symbols of our love and support for you, we have this certificate and a blanket that represents the prayers of God's people for your family. Thanks so much. We love you.
As we prepare to receive the Lord's tithes and offerings, again, that same verse just continues to come into my mind, which is, we know and understand that every good and perfect gift comes to us from the Father of lights, in whom there is no changing. He has called us to be stewards of all that he's given us, and that we would joyfully and cheerfully give so that his kingdom might be built in everywhere, and especially even countries in northern Africa that you probably couldn't name on a map, but the Lord is doing work there through people like Parker and Laura. Let's pray. Lord God, receive these tithes and offerings. Lord, may you bless them, increase them, use them in a mighty way to build your kingdom. And it's in your awesome name we pray. Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns.
Amen. Continuing with 1 Samuel chapter 17, beginning with verse 25. Now the Israelites had been saying, "Do you know how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage, and will exempt his family from taxes in Israel." David asked the men standing near him, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" They repeated to him what they had been saying and told him, "This is what will be done for the man who kills him." When Eliab, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at him and asked, "Why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those sheep in the wilderness? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle." "Now what have I done?" asked David. "Can't I even speak?" Then he turned away to someone else and brought up the same matter, and the men answered him as before. What David said was overheard and reported to Saul, and Saul sent for him. David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You are not able to go out against this Philistine and fight him. You're only a young man, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. The uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We're going to learn that this story is really not about David and Goliath. It's about David's God. And he's the one who wins this battle. So there are psalms all over, as Pastor Paul said earlier in the service, psalms that just lift us high to the Lord. One of them was written during a thunderstorm, Psalm 29. And so was this next hymn we're going to sing. A Swedish pastor wrote, "How Great Thou Art," after watching a thunderstorm and seeing God's power displayed in nature. So wherever you've seen God's power this week, let's sing to him, "How Great Thou Art."
I don't learn lessons really quickly. I sat down to watch a movie with my wife years and years ago, and it was directed by a guy named M. Night Shyamalan, and Bruce Willis was the star of it, and I'm kind of bored through the whole thing, you know, and then the very end, you know, something happens, and Daniel's like, oh, isn't that amazing? And I was like, I was pretty bored by that. I'm used to Bruce Willis, you know, defending America from terrorists, and this was kind of a left turn from that. And she was, oh my gosh, that was just so amazing. A month later, I found out that Bruce Willis was dead the entire movie, and that was his ghost. Like, a month later, and then I was like, the movie was amazing. Oh my gosh. But I didn't learn the lesson. Because then there was another movie came out called The Book of Eli. Denzel Washington. And I think Denzel and I would be good friends if he would give me a chance. And it's about the preservation of the Bible. It's an amazing movie. I mean, it's the movie The Preservation of the Bible, and I was just hooked about him keeping the Bible in this post-apocalyptic word and having memorized the whole thing and repeating it. And the movie was over, and I was like, that was amazing. Denzel killed 80 people in the movie. That did it for me. That was great. And a month later, Danielle was like, that was really great. Amazing to think Denzel was blind the entire movie. And I'm like, what? He was, oh my gosh, I got to go back and watch that again. I'm totally serious. You can ask Danielle. She's like, how did you not know? And I'm like, I don't know. I just have a man crush on Denzel. My point being that maybe even in this very, very, very well-known story, that there will be some things that will come out that will go, I didn't see that before. David and Goliath, I didn't see that. It's this, you know, byword of David and Goliath, and we just keep going, and we don't stop long enough maybe to go, well, what was the Lord doing? Because really, it's the story of God using a man or a young man named David to defeat an enemy to rescue his people. And so as we jump into the story real quick, David has been going back and forth. He's been sometimes at home, sometimes serving in Saul's court, and he's coming back and forth because the army of Israel doesn't get, you know, they don't have a mess tent to go through and get their meals. Their meals have to come from home, so David is being sent with food and provisions to his brothers to come to the front line. And as David shows up, he shows up to a standoff, and if you can kind of imagine two little hills, maybe, you know, High Brighton Mountain and Grandmother Mountain, you know, and then there's the Valley of Lenore in between, and, you know, you've got the Israelites on one army and the Philistines on one army, and for 40 days now, the champion of the Philistines is a man named Goliath who was over 9 feet tall. If you want to look back, you can see in the earlier part of the chapter from about verses like 4 through 11 describe, he's 9 feet tall, you know, has a spear the size of a weaver's beam. I mean, just wears, you know, armor that weighs more than David could ever even weigh, and just that he's the champion. And so in a champion warfare, when there's a stalemate between two armies, rather than just decimating both the armies, one will have a greater chance of, you know, having more plunder if they don't kill all the army. So they just choose one of the two best fighters and say, well, why don't you let them come out and fight, and then whoever wins, the other people will be subject to them. And so David shows up to this, and he begins to inquire as to what's going on. He's kind of like, you know, what is this? Who is this Philistine? What's going on here? Curious thing that Bob pointed out is that for as well known as this story is, notice that it shows up nowhere else in the Bible. Thought about that? Jesus actually will talk about Jonah being inside the whale. But nobody talks about David and Goliath. And one of the things that I think is incredible is that if we look at where often the stories of the Old Testament get retold, they get retold in the book of Psalms. And who has written a lot of the book of Psalms? David. And whenever David recalls God's faithfulness, he typically goes back to the Exodus, the parting of the Red Sea, the plagues. And David never is in there patting himself on the back. He's always shining the light on the Lord and what God has done. And so as we come to this text, we're going to jump in here and start at verse 25. So if you want to follow along with the Bible, starting in verse 25, David arrives and he begins to become apprised of the situation, which is interesting because he's a kid. So, you know, you have a child showing up, a young man, an adolescent showing up, and begins to kind of say, well, what's going on? And so we find out that Saul, remember about Saul? Saul was head and shoulders taller than everyone else. So even though Goliath might have been 9 feet tall, Saul was still you know, pretty prodigious in his own right in terms of height and in terms of stature, but we find him hiding out back at the palace, willing to let anybody else go out and fight Goliath. He won't fight him, and he makes two great concessions to anyone who will go out and face the champion of the Philistines, Goliath. You can marry my daughter, and you and your family will be absolved from paying taxes forever. And considering where we're going, like, there's some of y'all that are like, is there a Goliath that I can go fight right now and get in on that deal? I would like that. And so when we get to 26 through 27, David begins to go around and verify this report. You all know how this is. You know, you've been sent the online coupon for Kohl's that is, you know, 20% off plus an extra $20. And you call your girlfriend up and you go, did you get one of these two or is this just a scam? And so he's verifying these reports. What's going on? In verses 26 and 27, you hear David's zeal. Zeal that is absent from Saul. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Notice that he calls out God's enemy and specifically cites, this man is outside of the covenant that I am a part of. And can you hear the tightness between David and how he feels that the Lord feels about him and how he feels about the Lord? So verses 28, 29, 30, and 31, David's brothers get wind of what's going on, especially Eliab. One of the things that I think about these verses when I look at 28 through 31 is just a very simple statement. David's brothers didn't know he was David. Right? Like Michael Jordan's middle school class didn't know he was Michael Jordan. Come on. All those people in Pakistan didn't know that it was Bob Thompson that was there among them. They didn't know. And David's brothers didn't know he was David. All they saw was what they remembered him as. And this is also a word of warning to any of us. So often we have crossed paths with someone before they knew the Lord, in a place of immaturity, in a place where they hadn't learned what the Lord was working on them, and they hadn't learned the lesson, or they hadn't seen the next horizon, or whatever it was. And the next time we meet them, we assign to them the place that they were, the statue that they were, the person who they used to be. And we've forgotten that God never stops working on anyone. And his brothers didn't know that David was David. So they're like, get out of here, man. You're a troublemaker. Oh, you're just in it for yourself. So verses 32 through 33, I love this part because David goes to Saul. Saul hears about it, and Saul and David enter into what you and I would call a very rational discussion if you take God out of it. You know, this is simply, you know, like if Arndt Middle School comes to me and says, listen, we want you to pray for us. God's laid it on our heart that we're going to go take on the Panthers this weekend. You know, a rational discussion would be like, what kind of insurance do you have? but again, it's rational if you leave God out of it. But once God is a part of it, we have to go, what's possible with God? Anything. Anything is possible with God. And so verses 34 and 35, now David is beginning to recall his resume as a warrior. And he's beginning to remember in front of Saul as a testimony. And again, hear him, someone probably half the size of Saul, much less the size of Goliath, hear this person in David who expresses his faith in what God does through him and in him, and him saying, and here's what God is going to do through me. And once again, juxtapose the zeal of David with the absolute reticence and resignation of Saul. So verse 36, now David in front of Saul begins to make this connection. This same God that used me to keep the sheep, to defeat the lion, kill the bear, is the same God who is going to use me to deliver this nation, our nation, God's people, from this man who is outside the covenant that we belong to. I've got God. God's got me. We're in this together. God's enemy is my enemy. And then I love verse 37. Don't miss this.
In verse 37, we hear again the zeal of David as it blazes. I will go out and I will do this. And notice the phrasing of this. David does not claim personal victory. He says, God is able to what? Save me from this Philistine. He is counting on God's salvation. And that is such an important point. Not his personal glory, not his personal victory, but God's salvation. Now, as we read the rest of the story, you know it. It's amazing. Saul takes him into his locker room. And you can just see, like, you know, he's got his winter helmet up and his spring helmet up and his helmet with, like, you know, the fall color is on it and everything. And he says, I want you to try this on and try this on. And you can just see David just wobbling around. I can't wear these. I'm not used to it. So he goes out, takes his sling, 5 smooth stones out of the riverbed. And here's the important part. He goes out to the field of battle to meet Goliath. He doesn't sit on the couch because God's providence necessitates our participation and partnership. And then if you've ever wanted to hear someone in the Bible just talk junk to someone, read what David says to this guy. I mean, like, memorize that and just say it to the next time you're, you know, playing a flag football game. You come out here at me, you know. And then, of course, we know what happens. Goliath comes for him. He slings the stone, sinks into the forehead, and he falls over. Then David goes and picks up the sword. The sword, I mean, if you can just imagine this massive thing, cuts off Goliath's head. And he's a teenager, and you know how? Because he doesn't put the head anywhere. He takes it with him everywhere he goes. And at the end of the chapter, he shows up to talk to Saul, and he's still got the head. And he's like, don't let that blood drip on my carpet. And we see God's faithfulness in working through someone who says, I believe that the one who saved me will save me again.
After we take Pastor Paul to Israel next year, he's not going to say that this image is, you know, Grandfather Mountain and High Brighton and Lauren between. The size of this, the scale of this, is more like Hickory High School's football stadium. These are not big hills. You know, they're kind of minor hills, and there's not a lot of space in between them as these armies kind of face off against each other. In my view, and it's really okay, you know, people find inspiration in the story a lot of different ways. I'm going to give you Bob's take on it, and it's really okay if your take is a little bit different. I do not think this story is about facing and overcoming your giants, even with God's help. Like, no matter what my enemies are, I'm the underdog, and I can win because I got God on my side. Okay, I don't think that's what this story is about. So what's it about? This is a time of preparation in David's life. And the reason this is so, this is not repeated in David's Psalms or in the New Testament is because it really is a minor part of the grand redemption story of what God is doing. God has a people for himself, and he wants David as his great king. And this is a time of preparation for David. There are 3 stories in 1 Samuel 16 and 17 that almost look unrelated as you read them because they don't refer to each other and have very little in common, but all of them are about preparation of David. Number one is when Samuel comes and anoints David, and we find out about his heart. So David's heart is important, not the outward appearance. It's his heart. Second, we find about his humility. So he's called in to play the harp, to play music for Saul back in the background because Saul gets very upset. And we find out that David is willing to wait and just serve. He doesn't have to be a leader right away. And then we get to this story, which is really about David's faith, because David can't be David later on unless he has learned to trust God in the middle of a crisis. So this is part 3 of David's preparation for who David is going to be when we get later into the story. And it's a wonderful story. It's a powerful story. But don't just minimize it and trivialize it by saying, well, whatever big challenge I have, like I can win this challenge, I can build my big business, you know, I can overcome cancer or whatever. I'm not saying those things are trivial. I'm just saying this is so much bigger than that. This is about God's redemptive purposes and plan and history and the person he is preparing to be that pivot in the life of Israel. So let me offer you 3 very specific applications that I think do come out of this story. And the first is that faith is the evidence of things not seen. David refers to God in that speech to Goliath as the Lord of hosts. It is a name that we first met anywhere in the Bible in the first chapter of 1 Samuel, when Elkanah and his wife Hannah put their trust and regularly worship the Lord of hosts. This image is the God who is the God of the armies, and it's not just the visible armies in Scripture, it is the invisible armies. There are always invisible forces that are at work, and faith is the evidence of things not seen. You can read this story and say, for example, wow, wasn't it a coincidence that David just happened to show up at the very moment Goliath was introducing his challenge, right? Nothing just happens in this story. David is there at exactly the right moment to overhear this challenge, to speak to his brothers. One of his brothers is close enough by to ridicule him. David says, like, what's this got to do with you? So the timing of this story is really powerful. It's a God thing. But there's more than that. I was thinking all week, like, I bet David had really practiced that sling a lot. I don't know about when I was growing up in Pakistan, we tried using a sling. Anybody ever tried to hit something with a sling? Like, it doesn't happen the first time or the millionth time that you try it. So, you know, to put a piece of rock in, you know, two long ropes and whip it around, the little piece of leather in between and hit a target, Goliath, this 10-foot-tall giant with a shield bearer in front of him, is only vulnerable in one spot between the eyes. And it's not because David's good at the sling that he hits that spot. That is the armies of the living God that are doing this. I picture a whole army of heaven's angels at this moment, and one of them gets the job, like, you make sure the rock gets into Goliath's head. This is a God thing that happens. And when we think that, you know, things are just working out great for me, no, faith is the evidence of things not seen. And we see this, David is trusting in a God who can do this in him and through him. The second lesson is that the moment of crisis is too late to prepare. The moment of crisis is too late to prepare. So had David just showed up at the moment, which actually happens to all of these other soldiers, this is an unprecedented threat from the Philistines. Let me remind you of something powerful in this whole book of 1 Samuel. Saul has never lost to the Philistines. Every battle he's fought, he won. And not only against the Philistines, but against every other neighbor. So why is Saul intimidated by this particular moment? It's because the Philistines had borrowed from their Greek heritage. You remember Hector and Achilles from the movie Troy, or Homer's Iliad if you're really well educated. So the Philistines had borrowed a new strategy. Let's not have a bunch of soldiers killing each other. Let's just have our best guy against your best guy. And although the text doesn't say it, I'm guessing the Philistines first put this challenge out, and Saul's thinking, yeah, I can probably take the guy. Or maybe my son Jonathan can. After all, he has, you know, with his armor bearer, taken on, you know, 20 Philistines all by themselves, and he killed them. We can do this. Yeah, bring out your champion. We'll send out our champion, and we'll have a duel to the death. And then out steps Goliath from the ranks, and they'd never seen a 10-foot-tall, fully armored champion. So if you're going to fight army versus army, Saul's going to win. He always has. But he has a new crisis that he's never faced before. And the new crisis is this giant of a man, and both sides have agreed, like, whoever wins that battle wins. So there's a standoff because the Philistines don't want to chase the army of Israel because they know they'll lose. And Israel doesn't want to go fight Goliath one-on-one because they know they'll lose. And everybody's waiting until David gets there. But listen, the moment that David gets there and hears this challenge is too late to prepare for the crisis. So we learn that David, all along in keeping sheep, has been, you know, playing music. He has been fighting bears and lions. He has been tackling everything that came. He has been developing a faith life that was ready for the moment of crisis. Now, here's one piece of really good news in this point. That even if you're not ready for the crisis, and even if you lose the individual battle, God will use that one in your life to prepare you for the next time. So there's always grace that flows into the crisis moments of our lives. But this story is to remind us that when you're not facing crisis, you can't be passive. It must be a moment where you say, okay, God wants to prepare me. What are my connections? What's my support system? Where am I growing my faith through music and prayer and scripture? Where am I preparing for whatever comes next in life? That's powerful for what David does here in 1 Samuel 17. And then finally, the third lesson I want to draw out of this is that success is in honoring the name of the Lord. David was not successful that day because he cut off Goliath's head. David was successful that day because the name of God had been trashed by the Philistine pig, is basically what he calls him. This filthy Philistine who is cursing our God with the name of his gods, and this is ultimately a battle of the gods. And David is saying, why are the armies of Israel sitting here doing nothing when this pagan is trashing the name of our God? So for David to enter into this battle, win or lose, he was not going to do nothing if the name of God was at stake. And the question comes for us as believers in the middle of our crises, whether God has prepared us for them, whether we're prepared for them, or God is using it to prepare us for something else, or God is going to take us home. At the end of this story, at the end of this crisis, will people have a deeper reverence for the name of God than they had before it? Will people know in my life, in my walk, in my words, in my actions, I am one who trusts in the name of the Lord? A biblical story that sort of builds on this one is the story of Daniel's three friends who are getting ready to be thrown into the fiery furnace. And they say, basically they trash talk Nebuchadnezzar in the same way David trash talks Goliath, but they add this: our God is able to save us from this furnace, but even if he doesn't, we will not bow down to your God. And those were people that said, it doesn't matter what happens to me, it matters a lot how people view the name of my God. Let's pray together. Lord, it's such a humbling story, and forgive us when we make it about us. It's about you. May we be people who live into our moments in the confidence and the faith that you are good and you are God, as we sang at the beginning of this service. Good God Almighty, validate your name in the way we live our lives. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Hold it right there for just a moment.
Dr. Peter.
You know, there are times at which I feel I have not been fully honest with you. This is one of those moments. So you think that we chose this last hymn because it's one of your favorite hymns, and Lori and I tried our best to make it sound like that at staff meeting, and that's true. We chose it because it's one of your favorite hymns. But we also chose it because today we want to honor you for 20 years as our music director and organist at Corinth. So we have designed a worship service at 11 o'clock that you know very little about. You think you know what's happening, but actually the one thing that you have worked the hardest on for this week, it's a good thing you are known for your flexibility. We're not doing that piece at 11 o'clock today. All of the other performers know. They also have not been fully honest with you. We've got an entire worship service of your music that is planned and played and directed by others, so you can just sit and enjoy that as our tribute to you, and we're looking forward to that. However, there are three exceptions at 11 o'clock where we need you. We feel like the opening and closing hymn ought to be played by you because we want it from the organ and it's such a big part of your life. And go ahead and make sure you have Vitor Staccato ready for the postlude. Other than that, your family is taking you out for breakfast so that we can get you out of the way and we can plan for this 11 o'clock service. We got it taken care of. You can stop writing that piece you were still working on, you know, right before the 8:30 service for 11 o'clock. We're not using that. We will use it next week, and your musicians will be back to sing and play it next week as well. So go relax, have a wonderful breakfast with your family. Don't come back before 11 o'clock. And meanwhile, we are going to sing this hymn that is one of your favorites. And it is a hymn about the power of God. So you play, we shall sing, and yes. I think that needs an amen, Peter. Can you add that? Amen. I had forgotten the final verse of this hymn. Doesn't it fit? Let all who name Christ's holy name give God the praise and glory. Go in peace. Amen.